Sí.
Good morning. Today now we will now have a free paper presentation. The session will be chaired by Dr. Arun Kumar. Dr. Arun Kumar working as a senior psychiatric doctor in Atma Hospitals. The free paper session now over to the chairperson.
Good morning. Welcome to online version of IPSOCON 2021, and hope all the six presenters are there virtually, and request other five people to listen to their co-presenters so that we have more audience and you can go through how people are presenting each other. And without wasting much time, I'll go to the first one. The rules is 5 minutes presentation and 1 minute discussion. One thing, at the end of 5 minutes, you might be given a signal or so. Don't rush up. You can tell calmly. The most silent point is required. The first presenter is there, Minal Varghese. Her topic is post-COVID-19 catatonia in young lady with no comorbidities, a case report.
So, good morning, everyone. Myself, Dr. Milan Varghese. I am presenting the case report of a post-COVID-19 catatonia in a young lady with no comorbidities. I present it under the guidance of Dr. Pratik Sharma, who is the senior resident, Department of Psychiatry in St. John's National Academy of Health Sciences, Bangalore, and Associate Professor Dr. Priya Sridharan in the Department of Psychiatry, St. John's National Academy of Health Sciences, Bangalore. Myself, Dr. Milan Varghese, Postgraduate Resident in the Department of Psychiatry, St. John's National Academy of Health Sciences, Bangalore. So the introduction, as we all know that the SARS-CoV-19 has caused a immense havoc to the humankind in the past couple of years. The till date statistics shows that the mortality has been over 4 million globally. And the clinical presentation of the COVID-19 has been anywhere within the broad arena of anosmia to encephalopathy, pneumonia, and even neuropsychiatric manifestations as depression, anxiety symptoms, and even with some suicidal ideations are there in that broad spectrum. And the literature shows, in the literature search, we see that the SARS-CoV-2 virus has neurotropic effect. And we all know that catatonia is a neuropsychiatric condition, and which has been associated with various psychiatric, medical, and neurological conditions with various psychomotor symptoms during presentation, as in mutism, staring, rigidity. It can be any of these presentation which the catatonia that clinically present. And here in this case report, we describe about a young lady who has no previous history of any psychiatric or medical comorbidities, who had severe COVID-19 pneumonia, and further afterwards she developed a catatonia post-infection with COVID-19. So to detail about the case, the patient was a 23-year-old married lady who was a graduate, belonged to middle social status, economic status family. The informant was the patient's mother and her spouse. She had no history of any family history or past history of psychiatric illnesses. She presented to the emergency department with history of fever, cough, and myalgia for 10 days duration and dyspnea for 2 days duration. And during the initial examination, her vitals were BP, blood pressure was 100 by 60 millimeters of mercury, with a heart rate of 56 beats per minute and respiratory rate of 32 per minute, and her oxygen saturation at room air was 56%. The relevant investigation findings were APG showed a respiratory acidosis, and COVID-19 RT-PCR test was positive. CT's chest severity score suggested 19 by 21 score. And she was diagnosed with a severe COVID-19 pneumonia. And during the course of the hospital stay, she was treated with steroids, antibiotics, low molecular weight heparin, and she even required ventilator support as per the COVID treatment protocol. The patient's course in the hospital was, during the first week of hospital stay, the patient developed bilateral pneumothorax with right-sided empyema, which required intercostal drainage, which subsequently improved. In the first 1 week, she post-admissions, her vitals improved, and she was extubated from the ventilator, and her saturation she maintained with the support of 4 to 5 liters of O2. During the hospital stay, the patient had one episode of generalized tonic-clonic seizure. The etiology, the team had different hypotheses for the occurrence of GTCS. One was hypoxic encephalopathy, and further she required treatment with levetiracetam subsequently, which was changed to brivaracetam. In the third week of the hospital stay, the patient developed a catatonic symptoms constellations of mutism, staring, posturing, verbal aggression, rigidity, waxy flexibility, and automatic obedience. After ruling out other organic etiologies, the catatonia was diagnosed with an initial Bush-Francis catatonic score of 16, and which improved to 4 after 2 doses of injection lorazepam, 2 mg each at 20 minutes apart. Subsequently, the patient's catatonic symptoms improved with 2 mg lorazepam, 2 ID, but the patient also required oxygen by mask to maintain her oxygen saturation. So in this case report, two focuses we have to discuss. One is why exactly our patient developed catatonia, and another thing is that the patient is catatonic. The standard treatment we have is benzodiazepine, but how to kind of taper the benzodiazepines in a patient who is already respiratory suppressed. So the catatonic the hypothesis of catatonia in this patient can be, one is hypoxia itself causing hypoxic encephalopathy resulting in catatonia. Another is there is literature evidence suggesting steroid use for a long time causing psychotic symptoms, and catatonia can be in this patient, that could be a reason which precipitated the catatonia. Although the literature states that the post-COVID patient presents with a lot of long-standing neurological impairment, which long stands even after the COVID remits. So catatonia, if catatonia can be a part of COVID sequelae, although the damages has caused are yet to recover and the catatonia is presenting as a sequelae of COVID infection. And another proposal is that the patient was on antipsychotic for, I mean, antiepilepticus, as she had the episodes of seizure. So whether it might have caused any seizure in this lady, these were the hypothesis around these cause of catatonia in this patient. And obviously the treatment challenge the team had, we really had a tough time kind of titrating and optimizing the benzodiazepine doses, because we cannot be irrational in giving, thinking just about the catatonic symptoms and pumping with lorazepam, although the respiratory suppression part also needed to be cared of. So my conclusion is, in our literature search, we could find very rare instances in which COVID present, catatonia presented as a sequelae of COVID-19. And the team's challenge regarding managing this patient with benzodiazepine was something we required to discuss, because COVID has been such an immense terrible event in the last 2 years, and benzodiazepine is the gold standard treatment for the catatonia, and the team really had this tough time for the treatment for this patient. So we would suggest future studies on various acute and long-term neuropsychiatric manifestation of COVID-19 disease, and a practical protocol in which such a patient can be approached with benzodiazepines. We had obtained a written informed consent for the same from the patient's family. Thank you.
Thank you, Manil. Good. Here is a patient with COVID-19, young lady who subsequently was treated in an ICU and with oxygen and other things, and then subsequently she developed catatonic symptoms. So again, as you suspected, steroids could be the cause for catatonia, and then hypoxia. Finally, what your team concluded?
Because the evidences for steroid causing catatonia, we found more evidences for steroids causing catatonia in this patient. So we hypothesized that this patient, the reason might be steroid use.
Yeah, because most of what we have been seeing is the high dose of steroids which they give during moderate to severe COVID. So has its own complications, as you said that the sequel will be more because of the steroids. So we temporarily save the life of the patient, but at a cost of little more morbidity in their future. So thank you.
So thank you, sir.
We'll move on to the next presenter, Dr. Anand M. He's been presenting a cross-sectional study of psychotic disorder among adult population in defined rural area. Dr. Anand M.
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, please make it right. So, oh, yeah. Thank you, sir. Good morning, sir. My topic is prevalence of psychotic disorders among adult population in a defined rural population in Oscott et al. It's a cross-sectional study, sir. And my authors are Dr. Veda Shetigiri, Dr. Kasturi P. My place of work is Department of Psychiatry, MBJ Medical College, Bangalore, and keywords are prevalence, psychotic disorders, and rural. I will go with introduction. Rural community health centers, unlike urban centers, lack the health services. They have difficulty in referring to local mental health providers. The case of psychotic disorders hence are studied more among urban than rural areas. So I preferred this study. And there are not many studies which have correlated social demographic factors with psychotic disorders. Hence the present research instance to study the prevalence of psychotic disorders in rural area of Hoskote. My aims and objectives are to study the prevalence of psychotic disorders in Hoskote Taluk, Bangalore Rural District, and to correlate the psychotic disorder with socio-demographic profile and the participants. Materials and methods used were, study area was, I took the primary health center named Mugbala, and study setting was 10 villages under Mugbala Primary Health Centers, cross-sectional study, and 100 households of Mugbala Primary Health Center. And age group was from 18 to 65 of both sex, and simple random technique was used, and study period was 18 months. Tools used were semi-structured proforma, international classification of disorders, 10 mini international neuropsychiatric institute plus, and inclusion and exclusion criteria were, people belong to the age group of 18 to 65 years, people who gave informed consent. Exclusion criteria were, who are people who are suffering from serious or debilitating illness, intellectual disability, and those who did not consent for the study. Statistical methods were, qualitative data was expressed as proportions or percentages. We used SPSS version 25 and size score test was applied. Ethical clearance was obtained from our medical college. My results were, in my study in 100 households, I got 958 persons, and we found out 7 patients, and the prevalence was 0.73 in my study. In that, schizophrenia, we found 2 patients, acute and transient psychotic disorder, we found 1, delusional disorder 2, and substance-induced psychotic disorder 1, and psychotic disorder due to medical condition was 1. Total 7 patients among 958 patients. Discussion, we will go with the prevalence and psychotic disorders. In our study, overall prevalence of psychotic disorder was 0.73, and among them, 2 patients were schizophrenia, 2 were delusional disorders, and each of one was with acute and transient psychotic disorder, substance induced psychotic disorder, and psychotic disorder due to other medical condition. In National Mental Survey conducted in 2015 and 16, it observed that schizophrenia was 3 out of 1,000, and Loganathan at study also found it was schizophrenia was 3 out of 1,000. In our study, it was 0.73, which was less compared to other studies, because it could be the villages were near to the urban area and to medical college, and easy accessibility of treatments. And my study was including only 18 to 65 years, and we did not include the children and old age also, so it could be less. And depending upon the age and psychotic disorders, in our study we observed psychotic disorders according to subject age less than 20 years was 3.7, 20 to 30 was 1.08, 30 to 40 years was 1.04, and 40 to 50 years was 0.4. So it was highest in 20 years, 3.7. In a study of Fiona et al. Observed that standardized prevalence rate, there was no any found in across varies, and my study also found no significant statistical difference among each. Gender and psychotic disorders. In our study, prevalence of psychotic disorders in male was 0.7 and female was 0.7. And a study by Saha et al. Found that strong evidence that male have an increase of schizophrenia. My study found no significant statistical difference in males and females. This could be because gender difference are thought to arise from interplay between hormonal and psychosocial factors. As the social factors was better with this population, with the better amenities for treatment that they were treated, and so the gender differences was not identified. Marital status and psychotic disorders. In our study, among psychotic disorders, 42.86 were married, 14.29 were divorced, and 14.2 were widowed. And there was statistical significant difference between the group. It was p-value was 0.063. So a study by Zhu et al. Also found that marital status and the dysfunction of schizophrenia in the community is also found, played a major significant role in the course and progress of schizophrenia. And socioeconomic status also in our study, 14.29 were upper middle class, 28.7 were lower middle class, and 14 were lower middle class. Significant statistical difference between both groups was p-value was 0.21. There was a statistical difference. And I would like to conclude with my study that prevalence of psychotic disorders in our study was 0.73, and mean age of the psychosis was 28.4, and males and females were almost equal, and schizophrenia and delusionals were predominant among the people, and with positive family history, and there was a significant statistical difference in unmarried, divorced, widowed, psychotic disorders with p-value of 0.003. And socio-economic status as a middle and lower class showed 28.57 and 48. So lower class has more psychotic disorder with statistical difference with p-value 0.2. And other socio-economic, we did not find any significant pattern in religious specific factor. And there was significant statistical difference in unmarried, divorced and widows with p-value of 0.036. And socio-economic status, middle and lower class showed 28% and 42.8%. And it was showing a statistically significant difference with p-value 0.2. And interestingly, we did not observe any religion-specific patterns. I conclude with this, sir. And this was my original study.
Thank you. Well, it's a good attempt. And which rural population you used? I mean, you found?
Sir, primary health center, sir, nearby our medical college,
okay.
Around 10 kilometers away.
How many areas of population it will cover?
Sir, it consists of 30 villages. With random, simple random technique, I choose 10 villages.
Okay.
In that, I had 100 households. Among them, I had 958 people. With that, 578 male and 370 was female. And
that's,
I found out, 7% I found out of psychotic disorders.
So that's a good attempt.
Yes,
well,
sir, thank you, sir.
So you used mini psychiatric scale.
Yes, sir. Yes,
okay.
Sir. That for many, for only
for the identification of the
psychotic disorders.
But did you include other disorders like psychotic depression or substance induced psychosis?
Yes, sir. So,
cannabis induced psychosis.
I found out substance induced psychotic disorder one and one organic also, sir.
Yeah.
But I couldn't put any depression with psychotic,
okay,
or bipolar.
That is quite common. Because these are the patients,
yes,
which will get converted into schizophrenia in future. Similarly,
yes, okay,
first case of bipolar disorder again might slowly transfer into a schizoaffective or schizophrenia. So what suggestion is, you continue to study in the same village, okay,
yes,
for next few years or even more. Okay, if your hometown is nearby, then you can get.
I will do it, sir, because I'm in service candidate, and from this place only I will continue.
So you have to continue.
Study.
Continue with the same,
yes,
1,000 population. With the same scale is sufficient, I suppose. You can get,
yes,
inputs,
sir,
from your seniors. So as
you,
it will go for another 5-10 years, you will get more,
yes,
information,
sir,
and it will be a very valid study. Can be quoted
thank
at
you,
any
sir,
time. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. My chair will be taken up by Dr. Vinod Krishnadas. So he is a associate professor in Manakula Vinaya Medical College, Pondicherry. Welcome, sir.
Good morning. I welcome Koshatrat from to talk on the topic anxiety, depression, and quality of life among women with PCOD. Ma'am, you can go ahead. Dr. Kosha, are you there?
Ma'am, sorry, your screen, ma'am. Ma'am, please share your screen, ma'am. சார் மேம் லாக் அவுட் பண்ணிக்கலாம்
Can we move on to the next person because there's some logical problems from our side. So next we call upon Dr. Uma Hani. Umi Hani, are you there, madam?
Sir, I'm. Hello, yes, sir, I'm here.
Okay, ma'am, please.
Ma'am, make it slides over, ma'am. Ah, thank you, ma'am.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning.
Yeah, today my topic for the presentation, paper presentation, is a study of psychiatric morbidity among transgender population in a rural area of Bangalore. This study was carried out under the guidance of Dr. Kasturi P, Dr. G. Gopalakrishnan, and Dr. Veda Shetagiri from the Department of Psychiatry, MVJ Medical College, Bangalore. So coming to the introduction, we know that transgender is an umbrella of term which is defined by the American Psychology Association, where the persons who identify, who have gender identity or gender expression or behavior, who confirm with the typical who don't identify and confirm with the typically associated sex which they were assigned at birth. So furthermore, it was further followed like people who are assigned as a female but identify themselves as a male, or vice versa, who are identified themselves as a male but who are born as a male but identify themselves as a female. So according to ICD-10, that is International Classification of Diseases 10 and DSM-5, we know that like the concept of gender and ICD-10, they defined it as the gender is binary, whereas DSM considered that the gender is a fluid phenomenon. And the diagnostic category under ICD-10 is gender identity disorder, whereas in DSM-5 it is classified under gender dysphoria. The diagnosis you make is transsexualism in ICD-10, whereas gender identity disorder in adolescents and adults in DSM-5. The time duration is also different, 2 years in ICD-10 and 6 months in DSM-5. So we all know that the transgender individuals experience many difficulties throughout their life in each of the step of their life, like rejection, discrimination, which mainly affects the quality of life and also many aspects of their life. So following which, due to minimal employment opportunities, they end up like they have lack of education due to discrimination in schools and various educational facilities. They end up living on streets. Most of them are found begging on streets, and also without any choice, they end up into living as commercial sex workers. So they represent a vulnerable group who are at risk for mental health issues, of course, and seeking help is obviously not a viable option for them due to the real stigma which is existing and also due to the perceived stigma which is there. And the data is sparse, but higher rates of psychiatric disorders among the data which is available is present, which includes substance use disorders, anxiety, depression, and also adjustment disorders. So the aim of my study was to find the psychiatric morbidity among transgender population in a rural area of Bangalore. So my sample size were 60 participants from the age group of 18 to 16 years. Consenting transgenders were included in the study. Cross-sectional study was done. Convenient sampling was used. The basic socio-demographic data was collected using a semi-structured proforma, and to rule out psychiatric morbidity, a mini international neuropsychiatric interview plus was used, and the data was collected for a period of 18 months. Inclusion criteria were adult individuals with transgender dysphoria between the age of 18 to 60 years. The gender dysphoria was considered based on DSM-5, who fulfilled the criteria for gender dysphoria based on DSM-5, and the age group of 18 to 16 years with voluntary consent. And those having neurological diseases, intellectual or physical disabilities, or any other comorbid medical illness which interfered with the interview process, and also other non-willing participants who did not give consent for the study were excluded from the study. So these were the results which were found. So highest among the psychiatric disorders found were the substance use, where about 16% were using alcohol, and other non-alcoholic psychotropic drugs like cannabis, opioids were also present among the other 16%. The major depressive disorder, mild variant, was found among 15% of the study population, and moderate intensity was found among 6.6%. among which it was also found that none of them were actually taking any treatment for their disease. Adjustment disorder, brief, was found among 10%, and 3.3% had prolonged adjustment disorder. Dysthymic individuals were about 8.3%, and anxiety disorders, among which 3.3% had panic disorder, and generalized anxiety disorder among 1.6% of the participants. So if we say, check the studies and the literature which is present, Riesner et al. Has done a study among transgender population where they found that 11.2% had alcohol use disorder, which was higher in our study, about 33.3%. And Riesner et al. Found that non-alcoholic psychotropic drugs like cannabis, opioids, and some patients also had MDMA use, which was only 15.2%, but our study found 16.6% as the prevalence. And major depressive disorder was higher in Riesner et al. And lower in our study, that is 14.7%. High prevalence of substance use may be because of the easy availability of alcohol, and the increased incidence in depression can also be seen due to lack of social emotional support among these individuals due to the ongoing discrimination and stigma which they come across. So another study by Hosha M. et al. Found that adjustment disorder was present in 6.7% of the individuals, which was again higher in our study, that was 13.3%. It is again maybe due to the adjusting to new life circumstances, rejection by the family, friends, due to minimal, the freedom constraints are a lot with respect to this population when you compare it with the general population. Then another study by Hebar et al. Found that non-alcoholic psychotropic drugs use was higher, that is 46.8%, which was lower in our study, 16.6%. And dysthymia was 8.3% in our study, which was again higher when compared to Hebar et al. And panic disorder, however, was higher in Hebar et al. The higher prevalence of dysthymia again was due to probably of difficulties faced due to mainly unemployment, stress, due to not taking up jobs which they are not willing sometimes, and they don't have a choice, like begging or ending up into commercial sex work. The lower incidence of non-alcoholic substance use in our study may be because of the financial constraints they have due to the costly drugs, and also due to unavailability of such drugs, especially in the rural areas. Then Millet et al. Found that anxiety disorders were 7%, but our study found a low prevalence of anxiety disorders. The higher incidence of psychiatric disorders was mainly seen in the depressive spectrum. Mainly also one of the reasons could be unhappy cosmetic appearance, the burden they have, and also again the discrimination. So to conclude that this population is at a higher risk of developing psychiatric problems, regular screening and timely intervention is much needed in this patients and to treat their psychiatric morbidities. Educating their family, providing opportunities to access education, increasing the chance of having employment, to reduce their financial burden, which will in turn tend to reduce their tendency to beg or enter into commercial sex work, making them even less prone to abuse, which would again have more psychiatric morbidities among them. So promoting dignity, respect and equality among this population, increasing the awareness, reducing the stigma may play a vital role in reducing the psychiatric morbidities. Thank you, sir.
Well done, Dr. Umihami. It is really a good area to do a research. Probably our postgraduates even hesitate to take some special populations like the transgenders. But when a lot of studies have been in such areas, then some limelight would have been on these people, and the community can start accepting them in a better way,
sir,
as you have put in your conclusion. But
yes,
I have two doubts.
Yes, sir.
Okay, first thing was, is this rural area a hub of transgenders or it was diversified?
It was diversified, sir. It was
okay.
Not a hub of transgenders.
Okay.
The rural area which I studied, I had to talk to some of the transgenders there.
Okay.
Then with the help of them, I contacted other transgenders in other
so
parts of
the. So you mean to say that you used the snowballing technique?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Second question is whether these transgenders had their sex reconstructive surgery done or nothing was done?
Two among them of the transgenders who I interviewed had done their reconstruction surgeries. So
okay.
Others were actually working on it, sir, because they have a process typically
okay.
that they have to work and, pool the money.
Okay.
So once they pool the money, all of them work for one particular surgery to
okay.
pool for one person.
Okay.
Then based on the hierarchy, that is since how long they are living in that community, they get a chance or a priority to get that surgery done.
Oh,
so due to financial constraints, they were working on pooling money and then they were planning to get the reconstruction done.
Okay. Suggestion for you, maybe if you're really interested to perform some more studies on this area, if it's your interest, then you can consider studying between the sexual reconstructive surgery done patients versus the non-done. Because the hormonal, which has been, the hormone therapy which has been given as adjuvant can cause a lot of psychiatric disturbances which has been noted of late. So if at all, if you want to take it forward, you can consider doing something in that area.
Sure, thank
you, ma'am. It was a wonderful thing. A big thanks to Dr. GGK too also for taking this topic. Thank you, ma'am.
Sir.
All the best.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, and thank you, Mahoney. Next, we would like to call upon Dr. Vijayalakshmi Purad to talk on the topic. No, we'll go as per the order. We'll just bring him back at the last. It's not a problem, right? No, he has come up. Okay, fine. We'll go with Dr. Kosha Thorat. The topic would be anxiety, depression, and quality of life among women with polycystic ovarian disease. Are you there, Kosha?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yeah, you can proceed. Yeah, you're audible.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. I am Dr. Kosha Thorat, final year resident in Medical College, Baroda. My topic is anxiety, depression, and quality of life among women with polycystic ovarian syndrome. In introduction, polycystic ovarian syndrome is one of the most common reproductive endocrine tumors, affecting around 5 to 10% of women in the world, and in India it is up to 3.7 to 22.5%. Polycystic ovarian syndrome is characterized by hyperandrogenism, polycystic ovaries, oligomenorrhea, or amenorrhea. Women with PCOS are at increased risk for hypertension, dyslipidemia, and type 2 diabetes mellitus. The associated metabolic and reproductive features of PCOS, such as acne, hirsutism, menstrual irregularities, as well as the increased prevalence of obesity and infertility, leads to anxiety, depression, impaired sexual functioning, which adversely affect the psychological functioning and quality of life. The prevalence of depression is more in women compared to men, and it has been hypothesized that fluctuations in ovarian syndrome during specific phases of reproductive cycle play a key role in the difference. Further, women having difficulty with fertility were more likely to be depressed in some studies. Insulin resistance has also been inconsistently associated with higher depression. The aims and objectives. The aim of the study was to measure the prevalence and severity of depression and anxiety in women with PCOS compared to healthy controls. To study its association between various demographic and illness-related factors with depression and anxiety in women with PCOS, and to assess the assess and compare quality of life in patients with and without PCOS. In methodology, a comparative cross-sectional study was done in obs and gynecology department. Patients were diagnosed with PCOS as per Rotterdam criteria and healthy controls in single visit. GSQ-28 was used for screening psychiatric comorbidity. Anxiety and depression were diagnosed using DSM-5 diagnostic criteria. Hamilton Anxiety Rating Scale and Hamilton Depression Rating Scale was used for assessing severity. And quality of WHO quality of life brief was used for quality of life first assessment. Inclusion and exclusion criteria. In the cases, inclusion include women in reproductive age group from 15 to 45 years diagnosed with PCOS as per Rotterdam criteria, attending outpatient department in obs and gynecology department, and patient willing to give informed consent. In exclusion criteria, patient not suffering from any other disorder, hypothyroidism, congenital adrenal hyperplasia, patient having past history, already not diagnosed with psychiatric disorder and not on any psychotropic medication. In controls, inclusion criteria were female relatives of or woman in reproductive age group of 15 to 45 years, attending gynecological OPD and having regular menstrual cycle of 28 to 35 days after menarche, and patient willing to give written informed consent. In exclusion criteria, woman having past history of already diagnosed with psychiatric disorder by self-report or past medical records or not on any psychotropic medication, and woman with known chronic major medical condition. In the results, GSQ square, the total population was, cases were total 90 and controls were 90. GSQ score was positive in 40 patient in cases and control in it was 19. So it shows the statistical significance. For depression and anxiety, depression was higher among the cases and same depression was higher among the anxiety also. The p-value was significant. Depression and anxiety severity, cases were mostly of mild cases. 65.2% had mild depression. Moderate depression was found in 30.4% and severe was found in 4.3%. Same was for anxiety. Mild anxiety was seen in 53.3 patients. Moderate was seen in 40% and severe was seen in 6.7%. For WHO quality of life study, domain 2 and domain 3, which were psychological quality of life and social relationship, were statistically significant in cases as compared to controls. Regarding association between social demographic details, age, religion, and residence, age in 18 to 30 years among Hindu patients and residing in urban area, and height and weight more than significantly high had depression, and anxiety was found to be more in illiterate patients. Similar way, regarding illness-related factors, infertility was found to be more in depressive patients and hirsutism was found to be more in anxious patients. In the discussion, in our study, psychiatric comorbidity in PCOS was 44.5 in control, PCOS and in controls 21.1. Mean GSQ score was 5.20 plus or minus 3.29 for cases and 3.26 to plus or minus 3.11 for control. Depression in PCOS was 25.6 in PCOS and in controls 10%. Anxiety in PCOS was 16.7 and in controls 5.6. In a study by Chaudhary et al., psychiatric comorbidity was 50% and depression was 25.7%, whereas anxiety was 38.6%. In a study by Hussain et al. At Kashmir, psychiatric comorbidity was in PCOS was 52.7%, depression in PCOS was 23%, and in control it was 7.5%. Anxiety in PCOS was 15.45%. In conclusion, depression was found to be significantly high in age group of 18 to 30 years, Hindu religion, and in urban area having infertility issues. Anxiety was higher in age group of 18 to 30 years and literate individuals, and hirsutism was higher among anxiety patients. Quality of life, psychological and social relationship were significantly low in PCOS cases compared to controls. In limitation and recommendations, cross-sectional study was hospital-based with low sample size to generalize the findings. Some data was of subjective information, so they may have given information which they feel was socially acceptable, holding back valuable information. Age of the participant was 18 to 30 years in 74% population, which may have skewed the results. In recommendation, larger sample size is required. Study to evaluate impact of infertility and hirsutism on psychiatric comorbidity. Increase vigilance and routine use of brief questionnaire to identify women with depression. And initial evaluation of all women with PCOS should include assessment of mental health disorders. These are my references. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kosha. It was a wonderful presentation. Can I ask you a doubt?
Yes.
So how was the controls selected here?
Sir, controls were selected they were coming to gynecological OPD. Either they were the relative of the patient or routine screening patients. 18 to 45 year of age and they had normal.
No, it was randomly selected based on the relatives of the patient. It was age matched.
No, it wasn't.
Okay. So the second thing, what I would like to, it's just a suggestion. There was something put as marital status is NA, right? That is not applicable. Or you have not assessed in your table. If you can go back to your table. Are you there, ma'am? Umi, are you there? Sorry, Kosha, are you there? Okay. No, I think she's connecting back. Disconnected. Okay, fine. Thank you. We'll move on to the next person. Dr. Vijayalakshmi Purad will be talking on a cross-sectional study of psychiatric morbidity among residents of old age. Madam, you can start. இல்ல இப்ப அவங்க வந்திருக்காங்களா இங்க ப்ரீவியஸ் கோஷா ஹஸ் கம் பேக் இல்லையா சாரி விஜயலட்சுமி கேன் யூ ஜஸ்ட் ஹோல்ட் ஆன் ஃபார் எ மினிட்
எஸ் சார் ப்ளீஸ்
ஹா
எஸ் சார் ஹலோ
முடிச்சாங்க பட் அவங்களோட ஸ்கேல் தானே இது அவங்களோட பிபிடி தான் இது ஐ திங்க் ஷி ஹஸ் கம் பேக் டு ஆன்சர் தி क्वेश्चन சோ வீ வில் ஜஸ்ட் வெயிட் ஃபார் எ மினிட் எஸ் கோஷா யூ கேன் டாக் அபௌட் இட்
Sir, most of the patients, all patients were married, so it doesn't have any particular significance.
No, but you can put it as a thing, right? It's NA in the sense?
Sir,
they have PCOD, so do you think that all the person recruited from 18 to 30 were married? All the patients were married?
Yes, sir. All patients were married, so it didn't have any group.
Okay. And this is a suggestion, if you can take it in the right sense. Depression is obviously common among female with PCOD, and have you tried ruling out whether these females were not having any other comorbid thyroid issues? Was thyroid taken into conclusion?
Yes, but we didn't include in the study actually.
Okay, because that can have an impact on your study, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay,
it
ma'am.
Can
you can.
Confounding.
I think you can even consider incorporating diseases like OCD and somatization. They could add upon much more value because that is also most commonly found in PCODs. It's just a suggestion, ma'am, but the study was really good.
Okay.
Thank you, and
thank
all the best. All the best. Okay. Ma'am, you have to just stop sharing your screen so that Dr. Vijayalakshmi can continue.
Good morning, sir.
Morning, ma'am. You can start, ma'am.
Are the slides visible, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, sir. Good morning, everyone. Today I'm going to present on.
Ma'am, make it slides on, ma'am. Make it slides on.
Good morning, everyone. Today I'm going to present on a cross-sectional study of psychiatric morbidities among residents of an old age home in a rural area. The study was done under the guidance of Dr. G. Gopalakrishnan sir, Dr. Kasturi ma'am, and Dr. Veda Shetkeri ma'am. People aged 60 years and above are considered as geriatric or elderly people. Geriatric population will constitute 10.2% of the total world population by 2025. There can be several factors responsible for increased psychiatric illnesses during old age. Among few are attributed to multidimensional factors such as aging of the brain, fragile physical health, cerebral pathologies, poor financial condition and living arrangements, and breakdown of the family support system. Hence, psychiatric problems among elderly are common. In India, overall prevalence of psychiatric illness among elderly aged 60 years and above is found to be 33.9%. Considering the increasing mental illness along with the age and inadequate attention given to identify and treat the such patients, hence it is important to identify the illness and render the necessary care, psychological and medical support at the earliest to improve the quality of life. The aim of our study was to study the psychiatric morbidities among elderly staying at a rural old age home. The materials and methods used, the sample size was 60 participants of age group more than 60 years were included, and the sampling procedure, it was a cross-sectional study, and convenient sampling was used for the selection of the elderly living in an old age home, and the data collected was over the period of 18 months. The tools used were semi-structured proforma to collect the socio-demographic information, and mini plus was used, and ICD-10 the revision diagnostic criteria was used, and ethical clearance was obtained. Inclusion criteria were participants aged more than 60 years of an old age home and participants who gave informed consent.
exclusion criteria, people who have not given the consent. Statistical analysis was done using SPSS 22 version of software, and chi-squared test was used as a test of significance for qualitative data. The results were depressive disorders were more common among other psychiatric diagnoses. That is, around 24 people had that accounts for 40% with they had depressive disorders, among which 14 had mild depressive disorder and 10 had moderate depressive disorder, which was followed by adjustment disorder, which accounted for 8.3%. Among 5 people, 3 people had brief depressive reaction, and 2 people had prolonged depressive reaction, and which was also same as dementia, and which was around 8.3%, which was followed by generalized anxiety disorder, dysthymia, insomnia, and schizophrenia and delusional disorder were 1 in number. And 15 people did not have any psychiatric morbidities. Around 60% of the residents were females and 40% were males, and among which 34 were from rural background and 26 were from urban background. And 28.3% of residents were separated, and 23.3% were widowed, and 16.7% were divorced. According to our study, the predominant psychiatric morbidity was found to be of depressive disorders. That was around 40%, out of which 14 were mild and 10 were moderate cases. It is consistent with the study conducted by Kumar P. et al. At an old age home in Lucknow in 2012, which reported depressive disorders being the most common psychiatric disorders. The causes of depression in the study population could be loss of spouse, loss of family, dependency for financial and emotional support leading to helplessness, causing depression. In our study, depressive disorders was followed by dementia and adjustment disorder, whereas a study conducted by Shailaja et al., which reports 13 were found to be dementic. This could be due to lack of medical care and health facilities. If the inmates were staying with the family members, the detection of dementia would have been at an early stage. The lack of awareness among the residents in identifying mild cognitive deficits could also be an attributing factor for not detecting dementia. In our study, the generalized anxiety disorder was found to be 5%, whereas a study conducted by Hegdevi et al. In 2012 was found to be 2.7%. The increased incidence may be due to psychological and social stressors, negligible family support, restricted environment of old age homes, problems with adjusting. Our study also determines around 5% residents had dysthymia. In a study conducted by Hegdevi et al., found that dysthymia had higher prevalence of 30%. The reasons may be separation from family, isolation, financial constraints. A study by Kumar et al. Conducted at Lucknow found to have only one inhabitant of old age home was suffering from schizophrenia and psychotic disorders, which is consistent with the current study, which states one person had schizophrenia and one person had delusional disorder. So I conclude, the elderly residing at an old age home have predominantly suffered from depression, dementia, and adjustment disorder. The factors contributing for psychiatric morbidity could be loss of spouse, living alone, and decreased family support, poor physical infrastructure and health services in old age homes, chronic physical comorbidities, and restricted environment. Early detection, psychosocial mode of treatment, and further research is needed to assess the mental health problems in elderly and intervene at the earliest possible to reduce the psychiatric morbidity in geriatric population. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. That was a good study. Was the study done in one particular old age home, or it was from other centers?
Yes, sir. No, sir. It was from one particular old age home only, sir, because
okay.
I could get my sample size.
Were all these inmates being deserted by the family, or it was their option to get into the old age home? Because thus, I think
yes,
that
sir.
Has a lot of impact on your outcome, right?
Yes, sir. Few were not having family at all, so they came on their own, and others were came because the family was unable to take care of them.
No, there are two different areas which can have an impact on the outcome, right? Being deserted and being coming into the home as a choice has two
yes,
different
sir.
Impacts, right?
Yes,
even
sir.
That can
we
be incorporated. Okay.
Any family members,
okay.
they were feeling depressed for the same sake also.
Okay, fine. The last line of your conclusion is a message for the overall population or only for the population related to a geriatric home?
It is related to geriatric home also, sir.
Okay, fine. Take care. All the best.
Sorry,
Good, yeah, study. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. And finally, to conclude, we have Dr. Bindia J, who is going to talk on the topic relationship between somatization disorder and vitamin B12 levels.
Morning, sir. I'm Dr. Bindia J from Vaidehi Institute of Medical Science and Research Center. The study of
One minute, ma'am. Projected. Yeah, ma'am. Thank you. You can start, ma'am.
The title of my study is Relationship Between Somatization Disorder and Vitamin B12 Levels. It was guided by our HOD, Professor Fiaz Ahmad Sattar, and Professor Kiran Kumar K. Background, history of somatization dates back to pre-Hippocratic era, and journey starts from hysteria to somatization disorder, and in ICD-11, it comes under bodily distress disorder. It's a clinical condition where there are multiple somatic or physical complaints with no explainable cause and no relief of symptoms even after consulting multiple physicians. It's a disabling condition with a prevalence of 10 to 16%. Vitamin B12 level is also one of the essential vitamins which can lead to multiple somatic complaints, and the prevalence is quite high, and it's around 67% among the Indian population. The result, the vitamin B12 deficiency results in variable neuropsychiatric manifestations like peripheral neuropathy, myeloneuropathy, cerebral ataxia, optic neuropathy, delirium, dementia, psychosis, and mood disorders, along with the somatic complaints. Vast majority of them remain undiagnosed or overlooked, and low vitamin B12 levels could be either a cause or a consequence of somatization disorder, and also can be mimicking the clinical features of somatization disorder. So evaluation of vitamin B12 levels is prudent, and it helps in the management of cases of somatization disorders. So the study was aimed to study the relationship between vitamin B12 levels, symptom profile, and severity of somatization disorder. It is a cross-sectional observation study. In the process, 55 patients aged above 18 years meeting the ICD-10 criteria for somatization disorder were selected for the study. And patients with comorbidities and substance use were excluded from the study. Written informed consent was taken by all study participants, and after initial screening, socio-demographic and clinical data was collected. The severity of somatization was measured by using somatic symptom scale, and the burden was categorized as no burden, low, medium, high, and very high based on the points. And vitamin B12 levels were measured for patients. Less than 212 was considered as frank deficiency, and more than 500 were considered as normal levels according to WHO. And data was analyzed using SPSS software. The mean age of the sample was 36.31 years, and the male percentage was 56.4%, females were 43.6%. Marital status, 87.3% of them were married, and majority of them were from rural population. The education status of the patient, 55% were educated up to high school, and occupation, 75% were skilled, semi-skilled, and housewife. And most of the population was from upper, lower, and middle socioeconomic status, and both rural and extended family were all
Dr. Bindia. Dr. Bindia. She's connected.
Deficiency was categorized, and majority of them were found to be adequate and borderline. normal levels were found in 32.7% and adequate levels 25.5%, borderline was 20.8%. When the correlation was done between the sociodemographic variables and clinical variables, the mean burden scale was found to be around very high and high in male gender, married population, rural domicile, and people who were educated below high school. Patients with unskilled and semi-skilled occupation were also found to have high and very high somatic symptom burden, along with patients who belong to lower socioeconomic status. However, the difference observed within the subcategories were not statistically significant. The somatic symptom burden did not show much difference with the mean age of onset of somatization. It was around 36.5 years in people who belong to low. High burden was 35.5 years and very high was 36.7 years. This is what I summarized, and the correlation was done between the sociodemographic variables and clinical variables with vitamin B12 levels, and the mean vitamin B12 levels in female population was 711.04, and mean vitamin B12 levels in male was 419, and the differences between the genders were statistically significant. The housewives and people who were graduate and postgraduate education status and upper middle socioeconomic status were found to have low vitamin B12 levels. Higher vitamin B12 levels was found in illiterate and socioeconomic status, probably due to multiple vitamin B12 supplementation before coming to our OPD in illiterates and low socioeconomic status. The correlation between somatic symptom burden and vitamin B12 levels showed a higher burden in pain domain of somatic symptom scale, either back pain or pain in arms, legs and joint pains, and headache also. The correlation was done between the somatic symptom burden categories and vitamin B12 levels, and the mean vitamin B12 levels was around 525 in very high burden. So there was no statistical significance observed between the B12 levels and somatic symptom burden. Vitamin B12 level plays an important role in mental health, and it has been found that significant proportion of psychiatric patients are found to be B12 deficient. B12 deficiency can be a presentation of somatization disorder, or it can lead to worsening of existing somatic complaints and leading to poor prognosis, and it can also be a risk factor of somatization disorder. Measurement and replacement of vitamin B12 levels will help in the management of patients with somatization disorder. However, the reason for statistical significance not to be there in variable domains will be a small sample size, and also patients who presented to us were previously treated with vitamin B12 levels, but records were not available, so that is one of the limitations, and folate levels were not measured in our patients. There was significant symptomatic improvement with B12 supplementation who had low B12 levels, and it is prudent measurement of B12 levels is prudent in management of somatization disorder. These were my references, and thank you for giving this opportunity.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. That was innovative study. A small suggestion is, when you present such big tables and when you have alternating colored tables, it's always better to use a pointer which is available in your PPT. So it can highlight, or you can highlight your statistically significant areas which can be bolded. It's just a suggestion.
I'm not
for
able to hear you, sir.
What I'm meaning is, when you're presenting such big tables in such conference, I think she's
I'm not able to hear you.
Yeah, 1 minute. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
No, when you present some big tables with variable numbers, and you use this
bold, I mean, highlighting colors. When you use two color tables, it's difficult to find out the numbers which is statistically relevant to your content. So it's either you have to bold it or use the PPT pointer, so which we can flow, go with the flow, right? Otherwise, the study was excellent and good presentation. Thank you.
Thanks.
We'll call it off. It's over, right? Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Vinod Krishnadas, sir.